I'm Dr. Arif Khan. I'm a consultant pediatric neurologist, and I head the children's services in American Center across three Emirates. So I'll be chairing this session, and we have a fabulous program for you today with four varied topics, but all of them have a common theme, which is children. And I'm sure all of you are, in one way or the other, involved with the care of a child. Yeah. Let me just talk to you about American Center for Psychiatry and Neurology. The center was opened close to 7 or 8 years ago and started off from Abu Dhabi, which is still our main center. And then over the last 7 years, we've moved and involved Dubai into it, and now Sharjah even. So we've got three centers across UAE. The focus initially was started on adults, so covering neurology, psychology, psychiatry, as well as specialized psychiatry and psychology services. Over the last year or so, we have been concentrating on children. And we've now developed what is called as a Child Neuroscience Service, or CNS. I'll be talking to you about that in my talk, which is the second on the list. But Children's Neuroscience Service encompasses all therapists, doctors, physicians who are involved with children. So we work under one umbrella. So I'll give you details of this as we go along. As you can see on your brochures and schedule for the program, that we've got two excellent talks this morning, starting off with Dr. Adil Karani. And after the two talks, we're going to have a break, and then two more talks after that. And we finish off with lunch. I would just like to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Adil Karani, who is our chief medical officer, again, across the three centers. And he's a consultant psychiatrist, seeing both adults and children. He has, for a number of years, worked in the government sector, including Rashid Hospital, and he has been the director of training and residency program at Rashid Hospital, where his department was reaccredited by the Arab Board. He has been a psychiatrist in many private hospitals prior to this, and he also represents Rashid Hospital and DHA in regional and local activities. He's been delivering several lectures at regional and international conferences, and is a member of the expert committee for the development of practice guidelines on the pharmacological treatment of major depressive disorders in the Middle East. He has, or still is, the president of psychiatric division at Emirates Medical Association, and he represents UAE in the Arab Board of Health Specialization. So I would like to call upon Dr. Adil Karani to enlighten us on ADHD, please.
السلام عليكم صباح الخير شكرا جزيلا على حضوركم في هذا اليوم الشيق بإذن الله تعالى Good morning and salam alaikum to everybody and welcome to our today's meeting. It will be a very exciting and interesting meeting inshallah. My name, as Dr. Arif said, is Adil Karani. I'm a consultant psychiatrist. I see children and adults trained in UK and Ireland, with a lot of interest of delivering speeches to the non-psychiatrists, because it's very important that everybody know about psychiatry, especially children, which we believe is that somehow they are a little bit ignored. So we're just going to do an overview of ADHD. I think maybe we have 40 minutes, maybe a bit less. Okay. So it's also interactive. So at any time you want to stop me, please stop me. Can I know your background? You are counselors working at schools? Yeah? All of you? Okay. So do you know how many... first of all, ADHD. What is ADHD? Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder. So, but to make life a bit easier, we're just going to say ADHD. Just we start with, do you know how many of your students or pupils have ADHD? Any number? Anybody? Percentage? 5%? Okay. 2%? Okay, it's actually 7%. Okay. Classroom, what are your classrooms? Are you in a super classrooms or basic classroom? Are you classroom with 10 or with 30? 30. 30. We means at least one. At least one. Okay. So at least one. So everybody should have actually one ADHD at least. So we're just going to go through slides, okay? There are a couple of sentences very important. I wanted to draw all your attention to it. It is not accurate to say that problem associated with, sometimes we say ADHD with a slash, which means because some children, they have ADD, which means the attention is the problem, not the hyperactivity is seen, which of course makes their life is more difficult because they go under the categories of being lazy and nobody notices them, are products of poor parenting. So this is very important, okay? We're gonna have a few lessons as we go along. The lesson number one is I want all of you to put this, bear this in your mind, whether you are talking to the parent, talking to each other, giving out about a child, giving out about a parent, is not a product of poor parenting or inappropriate teaching, which I'm sure some of you and your colleagues are teachers, okay? In this case, it is the case that the kinds of the problems, so the problems that a child with ADHD comes, okay, place extreme demands on the skill of parents and teachers. Okay, I want everybody to start to be clear of that. It's not that the parents are bad parents or the teachers are bad teachers, but a child with ADHD, simply it makes you pull your hair. Okay? And you will see some of the mothers. I think if any one of you stands at the school gates, you will see some of the mothers actually, probably they are pulling their hair. And after that, they get in the car, turn on the music, and they start to burst into tears because it took them 2 hours to get two of their kids to the school in a uniform that is acceptable by the school. And then the difficulties are experienced compared to the same age group. So the first thing is we need to have extreme difficulties. So ADHD is not just talking about a child who's just having fun, just, you know, just walking around or playing on the ground, and then we say, oh, that child is ADHD because that child should. This is a classroom. I am a very strict teacher. They have to sit in front of me still for 45 minutes, say nothing, and don't move. So we are not talking about that. So it has to be extreme. And the other thing, it has to be from the same age peers. So the way that I see a 7-year-old, I'm expecting how the 7-year-old is acting or moving or talking or doing anything else. So I am comparing to the peers. 7 years old now, it is important because it is where we prefer to diagnose ADHD. And then we have three domains. There are three domains for ADHD. What are the most noticeable one? Hyperactivity actually is the most noticeable. Anybody knows why? Because it's more annoying. Yeah, let's be honest. Yeah. Let's be honest, it's more annoying. You have a class of 30 little boys or girls, boys and girls, right? And hyperactivity is the one. What happens to the inattention? They get forgetting. Yeah, if I have a one in, unless of course, like you are good teachers or good counselors, so you pick them up. But what happens is the hyperactivity who gets in trouble. And then, of course, they don't have ability to control their motor activities and, of course, control their impulses. Now, why or what is the core essence of ADHD? You are all, mashallah, are younger than me. If you remember the old times when you have a radio or if you have a dial on your car, if you have an older car with a dial on it. Do you know when you mix up between stations on the radio? What happened? You hear a little bit music, and then Arabic music, and then a little bit of Quran, and then a little bit of news. Everything comes in a one go, right? But can you understand any one of them? No. And that's exactly what happens in the brain of a child of ADHD. Yes, even before the jumping. First, there is a lot of signals comes to the head of a child of ADHD. Actually, let's put that around. All of us have a lot of signals come into our head. But we have the ability, or the one that they don't have ADHD, because some adults could have ADHD as well. They have the ability of fine-tuning. So they see a teacher is speaking, right? A bird is singing. Colleague is talking to the other, maybe a phone is ringing, so they have the control, the dial tone, to fix their attention on the teacher. ADHD child, they don't. So when you try the dial, they have everything in and they cannot make sense of anything. This is exactly what happens in the child with the brain which is affected by ADHD. They cannot fine-tune the signals. So at the same time that the teacher is talking about, let's say, a math subject, 1 plus 1 equals 2, or multiplication, at the same time, their brain cannot fine-tune to that because their colleague or the pupil or the child next to him dropped a pen. So they want to know what's happening here as well. And by the time they go to look at the pen or the pencil, probably something happens outside the window, and then again, that also draws an attention. So everything at one time. Okay? And that's why one of the therapies, one of the psychological or intervention is to teach them how to focus in a different way, whether they sit in front, whether you have a shadow teacher who keeps reminding them, or whether the teacher themselves, they keep grabbing their attention again, or give them maybe something less distractible, or giving them studies or information in chunks. So these are the symptoms. We just go through them very quickly. It is poor attention to details, unable to sustain attention. So even if they grab their attention, they cannot sustain it. Forgetfulness, dislike task, easily distractible, appears not to listen. These are the inattention part. Hyperactivity, fidgety, leave seat in classroom, runs and climbs, underly noises, excessive motor activities, and then impulsivity, of course, blurts out answers, fails to wait in lines, interprets talks and intrudes in conversation, interrupt talks and intrudes in conversation, and then talks excessively. These are the three domains of attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, which, of course, based on them, the clinical diagnosis, where a psychiatrist or a psychologist comes in, and then they diagnose, and then discuss later to put the diagnosis, whether to go with what kind of treatments. There are two subtypes. We talked briefly, AD, which is the inattentive, which mainly they are inattentive, and then, of course, there is the hyperactive, and there is combined. Okay? Now, 50% of children with ADHD have oppositional defiant disorder and conduct disorder. What is oppositional defiant disorder or conduct disorder? It goes more through the behavior, and now it is not only the concentration and, let's say, the basic, following the basic rule of a school, now we are moving a little bit to the rules of the societal norm, and later on, of course, moving into the law or into the doing other activities which may not be allowed, okay? So this is another talk, but the important thing is that if we don't treat ADHD, unfortunately, most of them, they get to ODD and conduct disorder, 50%, and what happens to them? They get expelled, right? And what happens when they get expelled? Instead of me seeing them at the school, I will see them at the corner shop. Until, of course, they end up into the trouble with the law, and then they get into trouble in the prison system. 30% is considered to have ADHD in the prison system, okay? So it is very important. I know now by law we are not allowed to expel children who have mental disorder, but some of the schools, they do another trick. They say, thank you very much for this year, but next year, find yourself another school. And then, of course, all the schools, they know each other. So the next school, they say, unless you bring me a report, okay, I'm not going to accept your child. Right? Yeah. Okay. But at the end of the day, our aim is to grab this child, help him to the maximum we can. And this is the idea where we have these days. We need to connect between the health, between the clinicians, and also between the education. So we need to connect this. This is very important. This is very easily treatable, and you can manage them very nicely and easily. And the opposite, of course, and the children or the young adults who have been diagnosed with oppositional defiant or conduct disorder, 80 to 100% originally had ADHD. And then, of course, ODD also developed to conduct. Conduct, when it becomes later, it becomes to the illegal activities, which means it goes a little towards the, most towards adulthood. Now, ADHD is extremely genetic. We're not going to dwell too much on that, okay? So that means you find their parents also having ADHD, their uncles, okay, their aunts sometimes, okay? And, of course, the studies are here for the identical twins. So if I have two twins, one of them has ADHD, there is most likely that 80% the other one will have it as well. That's in a scientific term or in a, for the genetic part, that means there must be something genetic that is split them to make both of them have a very high factor. Okay? Where is in the brain is located? Is the front. Okay? It's the front part of the brain. There are some theories about that. There are a couple of neurotransmitters, which are chemicals that makes the brain function. There are different ones, it's not clear, but the most important one is dopamine. Sometimes it helps just to know that, is that when the parents come to you and they say, okay, what can I do? My child is this, and all. And instead of blaming the child, it is nice even for you guys to use it. It's just a chemical imbalance. So the child just had some chemical imbalance. Of course, they will ask you why and when it happens. Then, of course, you refer them to Dr. Adil. I will explain to them. But the thing is that you can say that is a chemical imbalance. Instead of going and dwelling on you should be stronger, you should be more firm, you should have a better punishment or all these things, which honestly, especially in moderate to severe, it doesn't work. Now, there are a couple of theories. Some people theorize it is environmental, but is not very accepted because it is clearly genetic and there is a biological biology behind it, even though it is not 100% clear at this time, but with the advancement of the investigation system, of course, we're going to know. Brain injury is very important. A lot of young children, they fall, they hit their head, and that's where you see the change. You see a child is starting to change or having a sudden change. ADHD behavior could happen after a brain injury. Okay, so that's also another one. There is diet. Maybe that's another talk we need to talk about it. Will sugar make them hyperactive? Who believes sugar makes children hyperactive? Okay. That's scientifically that proven. Actually, no. Okay? They're trying to put the sugar, okay? But I don't know what it is. Is it either the research or the things? But you see, when they drink or they have sugar, they become hyperactive. But this hyperactivity is not ADHD. Okay? They tried to link two together. Nothing is found. Okay? So parents and teachers do link. Okay? Maybe it is good for health-wise, but there is no scientific background to it. There have been a couple of studies that I am aware of. I don't know if there is a new one. Okay? Preservatives, now the new things. Preservative and dyes are being considered that the one that they do affect. Okay? So there are some, I wouldn't say stronger, some evidence towards the dyes and the preservatives. The way that I do it, the thing is that I would do it is anything that colors the finger of my children, I think this probably are make them things, because I don't know what they are. They eat something and then their lips, everything is red. And then they start to jump around and then they get beaten up by their mom. And then everybody goes to sleep. Yeah. Yeah. Actually, the environment here is meant is the way that the mother is attached to the baby since they are born, right? From the time that they are born, how much hugs they get, when they cry, are they respond to them, are they getting breastfed, is the mother in the mentally healthy? However, what you have mentioned is the iPads or the things. Actually, it helps with ADHD because it grabs their attention. Okay, all these people who are developing the games are very clever. They make them to attract child's attention and also make them addictive so they cannot leave it. But post removal of these, yes, the children do go in a state where they could become either in a way good, so they focus on their attention on other good things, or they become angry immediately. But this is not ADHD itself. This is just a reflection of depending on a game, and then suddenly the game is not there, so you concentrate on something else. Okay, but if a child has a good concentration with the games, that doesn't mean they don't have ADHD. This is not a test. Okay, so the test is that can they sit still while they're eating dinner? Or do they move 10 times before they come, they go to the toilet, they come? Same thing is as a homework. Anything that needs attention. However, games are exception because they are made in a way with the music and with the colors and with the games. They are very clever, these guys. is that actually they do it very well, so they can grab everybody's attention, even adults. So there is biopsychosocial to it. So the extent and the nature of the behavior manifestation are influenced by a set of social psychological factors, experience, maturation, compensation, and motivation. So this is just a holistic approach of ADHD. But the genetic part is biological cause leading to the cognitive deficit is the main thing. And one of the reasons is that we believe in that because actually when you give them medication, you will see the difference. And it's one of the limited conditions in psychiatry that you see immediate difference once you give the medication. Percentages, we talked about it briefly. Actually, most of the studies have agreed it is 7% of school children. Okay? 7%. So that means one per classroom. Okay, so it's in the UK was a little bit less, but it still is 1 in 30. UAE expected to be the same. I don't have any direct assessment for them, but probably it will be the same. Okay, so 1 in every classroom. Well, now the schools are running up to 1,000. Most of the schools, they have 1,000 pupils. 7% will be 70 children, صح? 70. So imagine 70, how much effort they need. Unfortunately, most of them, they get lost, they get through the schools, and they get into trouble.
Doctor?
Yeah?
I read recently that the New York Sleep Institute actually feels that a lot of children that have been diagnosed in the United States with ADHD, they've looked at it and believe that they're showing signs and symptoms of sleep deprivation.
Mm-hmm.
And that with these, they've used children, and once they've gotten them into a better sleep pattern, they've actually seen the signs disappear.
Okay.
And they're actually, they came out, the Sleep Institute, to say, and this was actually studies worldwide, that they actually believe they could halve what has been diagnosed as ADHD and actually call it sleep deprivation. I don't know, have you read about
this? I haven't come across this, but maybe we need to look at it. Dr. Arif is here. He's the expert in sleep in children.
I have a section on that.
You have a section? Okay. So he Dr. Arif will answer that, yeah. Actually, the issue with ADHD, they will have sleep issues for two reasons, is behavior, and also they are comorbid. They do have a sleep. Plus, this is one of the side effects of the medication also, it may affect the sleep as well. So in extreme cases, we do resort with some kind of medication that helps them sleep and actually improves the next morning. But I'm not sure of the study. Dr. Arif maybe will elaborate on that. Now, ADHD, it is one of the examples that everybody needs to do something. One person cannot solve ADHD problem, which is good actually. Okay, that means everybody had. So it's important for the nurse, the clinical nurse specialist, pediatrician, to make sure that his ADHD is not something else, some other medical condition, hyperthyroidism, some genetic diseases, other ones, they could also resemble teachers. Okay, you have a group, let's say, like group support or group therapy where you get the kids into the camps or teach them how to the skills to wait their turn, to talk in turn, to make sure they're responsible for their things and they don't forget them. Of course, you have the psychiatrist, you have the psychologist, and then, of course, you have the parent. So everybody needs to get involved with ADHD. At the same time, even before getting involved, everybody should have an eye for ADHD so we don't lose these children. Okay? Why we don't want to lose these children? They're only 7%.
They're able to learn?
Yes, because they're able to learn and they will have a normal life. Because if you look at the genetic, most of their parents now, they become parents. They manage one way or another. Yeah, maybe they lost big portion, but in a way or another, they managed to do it. But if we forget them, yes, we're going to lose the 7%. Maybe not the 7, we're going to lose at least 2-3%, unfortunately. But if we put all the efforts together, it's very simple. It's very simple. Yeah, and it is simple. If you see some of the cases, maybe next time maybe we meet, we can present a case for you, and they do brilliantly.
Okay.
Okay,
I can say I have had a child in when he came to us in year four. He had done 5 schools already. He had been rejected from many schools. He's been with us since then. The 2 first year were horrible. They were really very challenging. But look at him now, he's in year 9 and really amazing, settled down.
Yeah. Because you will see the effect. It's one of the, you know, one of the conditions that you see the effect. And even the parents. I had one child actually whose parents, they were not traveling for 2 years. And unfortunately, I have, you know, the father was about to build him a cage. I shouldn't say that on TV, but anyway. Okay? So that's the reason he came to me. And now they travel, even they travel to Saudi Arabia in his car and they return. So imagine to have an ADHD child in an 18 hours drive going and come back. And they were happy and very good. Okay, of course, still he is struggling because of other comorbidities, but overall the difference is huge. Okay. Now I think this is what the psychiatrist does. Psychiatrists generally we do the clinical assessment. We bring the child to our clinic and then we do the assessment. You remember the criteria, we go through them. Once they fulfill, then the diagnosis of ADHD we can assign to. However, just to make sure, because at the same time there are children as well. So as a multidisciplinary team in our center, what we do, we refer them to psychologists. There are a few tests for them. There is Connors rating scale. Sometimes IQ. IQ is also associated. Not all of them, but some of them may have a, you know, borderline intelligence. That also affects their abilities. Okay, and then we rely on the school reports. We make sure that we get a feedback from the school. And also at times we do school visits as well. We're hoping soon to start the school visits to see the child in action during a class. So that will give us the full picture between the psychiatrist in the office and then at the school. The nurse specialist, we do the clinical assessment. It depends on the centers. Some people, they have the nurse specialist in the school. Some people, they have a counselor. So it's simply, it means whether they do home visit. It depends on the system, UK or in Emirates. Pediatrician is very important as well. If we have any doubt or thoughts that we want to make sure that the child is well, for 2 reasons. One is just to do the to exclude any medical condition. The other one is just to prepare a child if, I'm not saying we have to, if we want to start medication. And of course the teacher school reports. There is Connors tracing scale for the teachers as well. It's just a click they score the child of their activities. And then of course monitoring. It's important to see the feedback, what's happening, what happened after starting treatment. Connors rating scale is one of the best used. We use it at our center. Okay, so there are parents, teachers, and for adolescents, they can fill it themselves. It's a questionnaire, you get it, and then you fill it in. It scores in a way, and then you score a graph. Whatever you score, you don't know what is the final result is, so that's the way it is done. It's a nice way and plotting a graph. So the teacher will school not through, will score, or the parent not through, just a little, pretty much through, very much through. And then after that, it's a third page, if I can remember correctly. It comes with a score. And then we plot a graph, and it will show is it high on impulsivity or inattention or other things. We have also a computer test. I haven't put it here. It's called TOVA. It's very quick, it's very fast, and it's not expensive as well. The child come in the morning, Saturday, you know, they do a computer test. It's for attention. There is a square, there is a sound system, which the child has to follow certain orders. It also shows do they have ADHD or not. It's a very quick one, so if anybody wants to just refer young children for a quick assessment, it's called TOVA. From you can use it from 4 above. Especially now, most of the young children are very good with computers and iPad. You know, even they know better than us. So once you show them, they will do it. Yeah. And also, it's good. So if it shows that is invalid, you will see it. So you know that this was not suitable. We prefer to do it in the morning. That where is the maximum concentration the child has. It's not tired or coming from a long day school. Saturdays are the best. School visits. So we just see if there is discrepancy, if the parent saying something and the school saying something else. So that sometimes draws your attention. Is it ADHD or is it behavior? Is it the environment? Is it the home environment is chaotic? So the child is chaotic, and when the child goes to the school, everything is okay. Or the other way around. Maybe the school needs better discipline, or the teacher, maybe they need to just put more things that is done at home. And then a school visit will be very important. It has to be always second situation. The yard is also important. The school, the class is different from the yard. Okay? Where do they usually are in the yard? Who's here responsible or sees the children in the yard? Anybody? Everybody, yeah, okay. So what happens to the kids who have ADHD in the yard? Yeah. Where do they stand? Yeah?
Run around madly, hitting other kids.
Yes, okay, good. So first of all, they interfere with everybody and annoy everybody. And then?
They're not popular, they're alone.
They're not popular, they're alone. And then they're sidelined. Mm-hmm. Okay? So that it's not just because they are good or they are well behaving. It's just they are having low self-esteem because nobody wants to play with them. Because either they annoy them, or they beat them up, or they cannot do. Especially if it's a group, if it's a teamwork. So we'll do a typical scenario in a classroom. How are you doing for time? You're okay? Okay. So a typical scenario in a classroom. Okay, this is very important. Just put this scenario in your head. Listening to the teacher. So they start very well, fresh in the morning. Teacher starts, they're listening to him, get distracted because another child dropped a book. Most children are able to ignore that, right? So a book falls on the floor. So remember the radio, everybody just tunes to the teacher, they can. ADHD, they can't. And they start tapping and fidgeting. They start to move around and they start to do something else. Teacher finishes instruction. So the teacher said whatever they want to say, they have 29 or 28 or other kids to deal with, distracted with other children movement. And then everything is finished, everybody moves around, and of course now they are distracted. The child only received part of the instruction, bewildered and uncertain. Now the child doesn't know what happened. They get lost, okay? The child cannot do the task. And then may be punished because they don't know what to do the task, because they didn't take it in. Because by the time they were about to just grasp it, something happened. And then, of course, they get demoralized, low self-esteem, and then they start sometimes to act out or hit back. Okay? So this is very important. I think all teachers, actually all the schools, they should be aware of that before they start to demoralize or punish or put any disciplinary measure for the kids. Okay? Yeah? Is that typical? Yeah? Now we go to the yard. There is a second scenario in the yard. Okay? Messes more than plays. Disruptive. Annoys everybody. Okay? Interferes with others. Butting in. They're playing. They just go in. They can't wait their turns. You have two groups. They want to select their team. They can't. They have to go in and be with whoever it is. And then, of course, unable to play in a group. Cannot wait his turn. Because they can't. They put a ball and they go and kick, and their turn could be the third one, but they can't. And then annoys other by his behavior, refused to join in activities. So this is where the emotional part starts to sink in. So then he realized that he is not popular, people don't like him, or even people hate me, they don't let me play, and then gets isolated, and then gets demoralized again. So actually it is a double whammy at school. If you do this to three, four brothers in the house as well, so imagine, at school, the teacher doesn't love me, in the yard, my friends don't love me, and at home, mommy doesn't love me, or daddy, or he hates me. So see how the emotional effect of this affects the child. And we are talking about 5, 6, 7, 8 years old, okay? And it's nothing to do with them or with their parents. It's just to do that they have a condition called ADHD. Okay. Now, management, any questions so far? Yeah? Okay, it's okay. Go ahead. You can go.
Is it normal to see this behavior in 3 to 5 years also? Or we say that it's just because they are the, that's still the toddler to preschool children, they Changing the behavior transition.
Okay, before the ADHD is important. If you see a couple of slides back, it has to be two settings, right? So only setting without the child going to school, the consensus is that we cannot diagnose ADHD.
No, I'm talking about the preschool child who's in the nursery or in school.
Yeah, so now we come to the second part, is will the nursery or the KG do? We prefer not to put a diagnosis. Even for an expert person, you will know that these young children have ADHD. But of course, you don't give medication until they are six. In some extreme cases, you give below six. Okay? But for the expert opinion, you know, for the expert person, they will know that this child has ADHD. But you just give them the chance because it's part of their maturity. Their brain is maturing. If you want to go a little bit back from the biological part of point of view, it's just a maturity of the brain. Some of them, they get mature later. Some of them actually never get matured, 50%, which they have adult ADHD. So the idea is that we don't intervene, at least medically, or let's say from medication point of view, early, just to leave the child mature. Unfortunately, some maybe less experienced clinicians, they do, but this is not, should not be done. Should be all the conservative measures must be applied, all of them. And then you support the child to the last minute. But for the expert, you see certain children, they are. Yeah. Just here first, yeah.
I was going to ask you about the
Yeah, we'll talk about medication, yeah. Okay, I'll answer your questions, yeah.
Okay, I talk about the management. I work with early years as well, to 2 to 5 years. But I hear from my colleagues in the UK that their children with AD are doing something called biofeedback, which is very old, and it's apparently really, really effective. And it has a long-term effect after the biofeedback treatment. A year in biofeedback will still have positive impact 2 and 3 and 5 years later. I don't know that we have the same, if we have a year on medication and we take a child off medication, that it's the same positive impact. Is anybody doing biofeedback in Dubai? Is there anything similar?
I'm not aware of any formal studies. The formal studies that they have done were, maybe I think if you have time we can talk about it a little bit. The best study was done was medication versus medication and interventions, which is the behavioral therapy, plus information, plus psychoeducation. And of course, medication came top.
Can I just answer on yours? But back in Belgium and Holland, they're very famous, in Switzerland too. The thing is that it will work on attention and focus, but if they're hyper, not so much.
Okay.
There's one center doing it here, but it's so expensive.
Maybe, okay, 10 minutes. Okay. So maybe we need to look into the sleep and the biofeedback. I'm not sure if anybody doing biofeedback for children in Emirates. I'm not sure. But if anybody does, we are. So the management. The management is bio, psycho, social, and then there is others if there are comorbidities. So if the child has other issue, a speech delay is highly associated as well with ADHD. Again, if you imagine, if they cannot concentrate, they cannot learn how to concentrate on their speech. This is another time sometimes you need intervention because the child is not talking because it's always busy. The brain is always busy. So speech is very important. IQ is very important as well. That's why we always advise, especially in children. Children are valuable. Anybody doesn't agree? Children are valuable, right? But what you see, actually, people don't value children. I have children who are 5 years old, and they just make one sentence, and they come to me because the teacher asked them, and the father is angry because why do you take him to a psychiatrist? My child is perfectly well. He will speak. Yes. Last month I had a young child, 5 years. He can make 2-3 sentences. And still the father is not happy, and the mother did not come back because she told him he was very crossed. Okay? I have another mother who, 3 years, the child was isolated, depressed, alone in the room, and still didn't see a psychiatrist. Superficially, our children are very valuable. Yeah, we buy them iPads, we buy them mobiles, we take them to Dubai Mall. But reality, when they have a problem, no, they are children. They will grow out of it. Yes, they will grow out, hopefully they will grow out of it, but by the time they are demoralized, isolated, and basic characters are not being built. So when I see a hyperactive, speech issues, IQ issues, get them assessments. Okay? And make sure you find the right people to assess them. Okay? The good thing about Dubai is you can check everybody's certificate. And you go on the internet and check who has. Because this is another issue for all of you to be aware of. Not everybody is expert. Okay? So make sure you refer people to the expert people. Again, for one reason and one reason only. Children are valuable. Okay? And anything you do, you're going to have a huge reward in the future. Unfortunately, the vice versa is true. If you don't do, you're going to have a huge problem later. Okay? So just because a child cannot pronounce a word or cannot do something or having a couple of falls or hyperactive or keep fighting or crying or biting, he will grow out of it. I personally don't like this. He will grow out of it. Get him checked out. Nobody's going to say anything about looking, even if it's come. Yeah?
Can I just ask, when you said go online and check qualifications, is there like a...
I think DHA, you can find their license.
DHA.
Yeah. And actually, all the centers, you have the right to ask for their qualification, to the license.
CDA
also, yeah. Okay? So don't send, because some people are working from home, some people coming from abroad, some people coming from other places that may not qualify. So these are important, okay? Put your children into the right hand, the right people that you trust. And after a while, you know one or two psychologists or psychiatrists, and you know one psychiatrist, keep good friend with them. Don't lose them. Okay, that's the trick. Okay, so the other comorbidities are very important. We're not talking about them today. The psychosocial and there is the biological. Biological is divided into three departments. We start from the stimulants. Okay, Ritalin, I think, is the famous one. Non-stimulants, and then diet or fish oils. So stimulants, there are methylphenidate, which is Ritalin. There is a lot of media about it. It is stimulants. Yeah, it is similar to, yeah? Yeah, we'll talk about that, about the growth. Okay, and then there are others. There's dexamphetamine is not available in Emirates. Mixed salt amphetamine also is not available. Pimoline also not available. So in Emirates, actually, we have two medications. One is a stimulant, one non-stimulant. We are a little bit, unfortunately, very stricted with the medication. And that causes a lot of issues in the severe cases where neither works. Okay. So methylphenidate, we have Ritalin, and unfortunately, Ritalin, the short-acting, again, is not available in private, so we rely on the Concerta, which is long-acting. Briefly, Concerta, it is same as Ritalin. A child takes it after breakfast in the morning. We'll tell you why after breakfast, and it releases three doses, immediate dose, a dose after 4 hours, and then a dose after 8 hours, hoping that will last from, let's say, 6 or 7 in the morning until 3, 4 in the afternoon. The company says it lasts for 12 hours, but from experience, if it lasts 10 hours, I think I should be happy. Okay? So usually by 10 hours, the child should have done their homework. So this is the idea. Okay? The other two are the short-acting, 4 and 5. You have to give the child 3 times, and I don't think any school will give a child Ritalin in the school. In UK, they used to do it, but in Emirates, people don't like to take responsibility for giving. You know, like just Ritalin is special, it's narcotic. In Emirates, it's considered narcotic. You cannot bring it from outside unless you have a letter. You cannot keep it until you have a letter. Even if the parents hand it to you, you cannot take it off them. It is narcotic. Narcotic is, even for me as a psychiatrist, narcotic is considered, is difficult. So just check with the school admin and let them contact the MOH. If they give you the license, خلاص, that's fine. No problem.
Maybe yeah. I'm taking
Atendrol. What is this? This is the long acting, I think. It's Ritalin as well.
Atendrol.
Still, they should have a letter. Mm-hmm. If it goes under, it is, yeah.
This is any serious side
effects? Yeah, we'll talk about the side effects, right? These are the side effects. We have appetite suppressant, so it makes child not eat. That's why it is after breakfast. So you make sure they have a good breakfast, and then you give them the medication. And then they may not have their lunch. So when they come back, the effect goes away around 3, 4, 5 o'clock. And then you make sure, or the parents make sure, that they have something to eat. And even if the effect continues, before they sleep, they have to have something to eat. Otherwise, they could lose weight. I think we just have a few minutes to go. Sleep disturbance, another one. So it's to watch out for. Stomach aches, it should go away. Exacerbation of tics. Tics are also sometimes get worse with the stimulants. You have weight loss, headache, and jitterness. Most of them, they go away, but they need to be under supervision of a psychiatrist or a pediatrician, or just to make sure that they don't suffer. The appetite suppressant, when they start to lose, especially a small child, 2-3 kilos or even more, you need to watch out for. Okay. Now, growth retardation. The studies or people have always complained that these medications makes people shorter. So the study was done for 2 years follow-up. Actually, what they have shown, yes, the group that they took stimulants, right, and the group that did not take stimulant. The one who did not take stimulant, on average, they were taller than the one who took stimulants. However, when they both stopped, both of them, they reached to be as like each other. Okay, so it doesn't make your child shorter. However, some studies show this may delay their growth. Okay, but that's why we need to take a weight, at height, and blood pressure. Good question. The best studies have done is 2 years, right? So the studies, which means 2 years. However, we give them two ways we can do it. The school that says ADHD is for life, you give them until they manage to go through your education, university, and potentially work. And then, of course, the school that says once they are more able to handle their symptoms, to control it, you stop the medication. So it's a clinician's judgment, but the longest study, 2 years. But we give them beyond. What I do personally, I give them as long as it's needed. You have some of them after teenage life, they become better, they are more aware of their condition, they are matured enough, and then you stop it for them. And there are other people who are going through their GCSE or they want, their school, high school, they want grades. You don't want them to lose their grades just because they want their own medication. So once they finish, and then you can... you can stop it between their big holiday, like, yeah.
When does the growth catch up, though?
The study shows after 2 years, after follow-up 2 years, after the first 2 years of the medication.
Still taking, like you're saying, if a child could possibly be on it for 6-7 years.
Yeah.
So they're not going to have growth during that time?
No, it's just that the study shows. It doesn't mean that they will not have growth. That's why you need a growth chart. But overall, that's the study when the study was done. So it is not that it reduces growth. The only findings that they found is that the group that they did not take a stimulant were taller. But there are other issues as well, because they found that originally the people who went in the study, the group who did not take the medication, were taller to start with. But anybody who were expected, let's say, to be 1 point whatever centimeter, they ended up to be 1 point whatever centimeter after stopping the medication.
Oh, that's what I mean. So this study was after 2 years, all these children stopped the medication.
Yeah.
So what I'm asking is, what about children
who are not stopped medication? There are no studies now. There is no studies of long-term follow-up, unfortunately.
Okay. So would it be recommended that there are breaks?
Some people, they do that, but again, you balance, because ADHD is a lifelong, or it affects everything, not only the studies. ADHD used to be thought about, it is just you give a medication so they have a good score, but this is not true. ADHD affects the emotion, the capabilities, the cognition, the social interaction. So it's a clinical judgment how you go about it, and is the child needs it or not. Yeah, but that's the stimulant. But now there are other medications as well, which they do not affect the growth. Yeah.
Can I ask you also, what is the maximum dose that we give to a
teenager? 54 of Concerta. It depends on the medication, but also it depends on the clinical judgment as well.
So a child who looks...
It depends on their body build. It's per weight.
72, is that possible?
Yeah. Yeah, you could do 72. Some adults, of course, or they have a bigger, you could go even higher. But all this depends on the clinical judgment, because the higher you go, the more side effects you have. So you need to make sure you're in line with the psychiatrist and pediatrician or an internist. And you need to also watch out if they have a family history of any heart condition as well, because they are a stimulant. You know, a stimulant stimulates the body, make you more active, but it improves the concentration. It's a clever medication. Okay, so contraindication, previous sensitivity. Some people are sensitive. Glaucoma, symptomatic cardiac disease, important. Hyperthyroidism, hypertension, and of course a medical history. That's why we need to refer them to pediatrician as well. Okay. I think we just have a couple of more slides, Dr. Arif, so we just finished. So monitoring progress at school, very important. Some studies say 5 to 10% improvement in their grades. Appetite, we need to monitor weight and height. There is chart plotting. So if there is a significant growth retardation, you need to discuss the management. Blood pressure is another one. Mood changes, withdrawn and tearful. Sometimes it causes depression when you start, and that's you need to stop it immediately. Okay, so some children get withdrawn and isolated and tearful. So if that happens, that means the stimulant is not for them. There is non-stimulant, we didn't talk about it here, that is called Stratera. Okay, it acts longer, it takes 5 weeks to start working. It is cleaner, but however, the effect takes longer and it's less, not less, it's equal to a stimulant, but it's not as clear as you see it with Concerta. Concerta, you give them today, after a week, you see the difference. Stratera, you give them today, you need to wait until they go later. But they are easier, you can give them once a day, improves the sleep, less side effect, and also the only thing is you need to convince the parents to wait for a few weeks. And then there is behavioral. The behavioral goes through the parents and child. I think probably most of you are more expert than me in this field. So it's just improving parenting skills and strategies, based social learning theory, which is modeling. Think what you do, your children copy you. Direct instruction, make sure the instruction is direct, focused, the child is focusing on you, you grab their attention, your words are clear, and then role-playing. Improves child management, no effect on core symptoms. So the symptoms will be there. It's not going to treat ADHD. This is very important, and that's why we need to dwell more on what is the biofeedback. It's not that you treat ADHD, but you just control the way it shows outside. Does not enhance the effect of medication. Social skill groups, these are also very important. We started one a few months ago. We're hoping to start another one again. Reinforcement of positive behavior, academic achievement, respond for disruptiveness, delivered by trained therapist, camp counselor, or teacher. Camps target the interaction between child and peers and adults. When you get 5, 6 ADHD children, you start to give them, to sit together, talk together, go out together, just go to the malls and make sure that they know what are the social norms and how they can interact with everyone else.
What age group are you running
now? I think it was 12 to 16 we were running, but we were willing to go younger. It depends on the number of the groups that we have. And then social skills group, positive behavior, of course. I think we did that. So we have others. CBT has been involved, enhanced self-control, short-term improvement. Psychoeducation is another one. So the studies show it's very beneficial if it's being delivered by expert person. So if you're just handing them the videos and the leaflets, the studies have shown it doesn't work much. It's better to be delivered as a full session of someone who is expert. To give them to the parents, and there I think most of them are available on the internet, but the person who delivering should be expert. Course and prognosis can be identified reliably. Preschool children, that's one of your questions. Learning impairment, aggression, language delay, all these are query ADHD. I'm not saying they are, but query. Hyperactivity, restlessness settles with age, but that's because they get more control of there, because an adult cannot keep moving around, okay? But it doesn't mean that inside, internally, they're not feeling restless. Inattention, impulsivity persist, 50% into adolescence and 50% of adolescents into adulthood. So we have nearly 50 to 25%, they will be even when they're adult, and that will affect their job. So the same thing with the schools, they do at the jobs. They move jobs, they cannot finish tasks, they never do anything. People get bored with them. They get bored with themselves as well. And of course, finally, I think I have to finish now. Substance misuse, 5 times. A child with ADHD versus child no ADHD, 5 times they have higher rate of substance use. Always it starts with the smoking. And of course, it ends up with whatever is available at that country. Antisocial behavior. That when we talked about, if he starts with trouble at the schools, he gets kicked out of the schools, trouble at the local shop, and then he ends up as it goes along. And of course, depression and anxiety, and significant less academic achievement. All the studies have shown that academic achievement is significantly lower in children with ADHD or in adults who had ADHD as a children. Severity, persistent symptoms are a poor outcome, adverse psychosocial circumstances, unstable family, abuse or other issues, lower socioeconomic, all this makes ADHD worse, their outcome, comorbidity as well, and of course parent history as well. So conclusion, finally, ADHD in children is not a result of carer's lack of parenting skill. Medication is the main treatment and it does work. Yeah. And these are our children or our team in Dubai at American Center. And thank you very much. Thank you very much.